people of Earth.
The name's Nukem, Duke Nukem.
This is Happy T. Cat.
This is Albert Wesker.
I'm Hatchworth from Steam Powered Giraffe.
You're listening to The Rock Show on VoxVii.com.
Listen to Conrad and Lucas.
Take Geek Culture off the shelf and show it to you.
The spine from Steam Powered Giraffe says so.
Don't change the channel.
I know where to find you, bud.
Hail to the king, baby.
Hi, I'm Conrad.
I'm Lucas.
And you're watching Season 3, Episode 12
yes.
of The Rack Show on VoxVii's YouTube channel, hopefully also on VoxVii.com and TheRackShow.com.
Little behind the scenes, we're actually filming Episode 12 now.
Time travel.
And then after this episode, we're filming Episode 11, which you saw last week.
It's a big ball of wibbly-wobbly, timey-wimey stuff.
Because we have big announcements. Obviously, you know the announcement if you listen to episode 11.
Yeah, so you know before us.
Yeah.
Pretty much. But you can also pay attention to us on our Twitter and our Instagram, The Rack Show, all one word. Hey, Lucas, where are we?
We're in I3.
We are.
Go to i3.com. No, i3detroit.com. Sorry.
He's a member.
I've had a long weekend.
Yeah, me too.
I've had a long weekend.
What did you do this weekend, Lucas?
I was a volunteer chaperone for the Special Olympics of Michigan.
That's really nice.
That was fun.
It's really...
I did a lot of fun stuff. I can't really talk
fuzzies.
About the funny stuff.
The fuzzies.
But I did a lot of fun stuff.
That's awesome.
That's good. I was there since Thursday night. Came home last night. I was exhausted. I was going to call you. I was going to be like, Amanda's here with us. I was going to call Amanda. I'm like, hey, you want to go... do something, and I was like, nope, I'm just going to go to bed. So
doesn't have the stamina of youth.
Nope.
I'm settling into Port Huron. My cat peed on my brand new bed.
Really?
Yep.
I just owned it for
16 hours, and then my roommate shut my door when she woke up, because she worked mornings and I worked nights. We're at the exact opposite schedule, and I'm right off the kitchen, so she's being nice, and she closed my door because I had it cracked for my cat to get out, and Sarah was stuck in my room, and... she had to do her business, and the litter wasn't set up there yet. That might have been where she was lying. I don't know. I have no idea.
She's like, I don't lay here.
It was the one regular thing, because it had my bedding on it, and I think that it had my scent and her scent and everything from my old place. So it was the only thing that she could be like, this is mine, and I want to make sure everyone knows it's mine, because there's another cat in the,
oh, there's another
in
cat
the place
there.
As well. Yes. Huh? So she was like, that cat is going to know that this is mine. She peed on my leg.
Well, you know what you need to do? You need to show her up. You need to pee on it now. I was like, no, this is actually mine.
No, as a matter of fact, I need to clean it up because it's a brand new mattress that your buddy Jamie sold me, and I don't want to mess it up anymore because it's awesome.
And
it's so
comfortable.
Then
you need to pee on it and be like, look, this is mine.
No, what I need to do is I need to show her who's boss, and I need to take a gigantic dump in her litter and be like, this is how it's done, all right? Don't mess with me. You got to one-up me. One-up it, okay?
Your roommate's going to come home and you're squatting. She's going to be like, what the hell did I get into?
Just don't ask.
She just keep walking.
All right, well, I think that's a great segue into our guest.
Thank you.
No problem. I just figured,
you were here last year.
Yeah, Mandalynn Carlson, you hung out with us last year for our Next Generation episode.
Yeah.
Fun stuff.
Yeah. And you're back in Michigan, because that's where you're from.
I am back.
You've been here for about a month now.
Yeah. I came the 1st of May, and I'm leaving June 4th.
You had a busy year since the last time you were on the show?
Oh, yes. It was totally busy. It was really, really fun. Now
I'm going to interrupt you and just ask everybody who maybe hasn't watched last season, tell us a little bit about yourself. Like, you're a big deal. Tell us why you're a big deal.
Oh, I'm an actress.
Yep.
That's the whole thing. That
She's really great at this. If she doesn't have a script, she doesn't know what to say.
Yeah exactly.
Well, tell us some of the projects you've worked on.
Okay, I had three movies in Walmart, A Horse for Summer, Small Town Santa, and Deadly Sanctuary. Two movies on Netflix, A Horse for Summer, and then Small Town Santa. I was on Scandal, CSI
New
York.
The show,
yeah,
the
Scandal,
show.
The show.
Were you a body?
A Disney...
No,
no I was...
The...
Good job not dying.
I was a love child.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, love child. Awesome. Okay.
And then I was just on an episode of Disney's I Didn't Do It.
Yeah, which is really popular right now with the young crowd.
I guess, yeah.
Yeah.
What were you in that?
You were also
an athlete.
You were also on Kimmel.
Was a boy.
You were on Jimmy Kimmel.
Yeah, I was on Jimmy Kimmel. I did a skit for them.
Christmas skit.
Yeah.
Reindeer in the Mirror.
Yeah.
Check it out on YouTube.
See, he knows more than me.
Reindeer. She's also did stand-up comedy in Las Vegas.
Oh, no, no, no. It was in Hollywood, the Hollywood Improv.
Okay, so she did stand up at the Hollywood Improv, which is something
arguably more impressive.
Yeah.
This is a horse for summer. She's not the horse we talked about before the show.
But she is summer.
She's actually summer. She's right there next to Dean Cain, a.k.a. Lois and Clark, The New Adventures of Superman. Superman.
He was just in town last week.
Yeah.
Motor City Comic Con.
Did you hang out with him?
I did, yeah. It was our...
Just calling up Superman, hey, what's up?
That was our second film together. We had done Small Town Santa, the one that was in Walmart and Netflix. And then we did a third one, Deadly Sanctuary, which also went into Walmart. And I think we're lined up to do a fourth.
I didn't know about Deadly Sanctuary. I haven't bought that one
yet. It's.
Yeah, you're saying buy it. Buy it.
Totally.
Go to Walmart.
I don't think it's still in Walmart. I think they took it out. Oh. It's based off of a book that this lady wrote in Arizona, and she takes these headlines, the newspaper headlines, and she writes them, and she just turns them into this book. And I opened the film with it was a small scene, but it's a murder mystery of it's just a whole bunch of stuff.
Can I make a prediction? You are the murderer. You did it.
You'll just have
you
to
did
find
it.
Out.
I might be right, so you need to check that out. So you were a troubled teen in this one.
I was a troubled teen.
Are you? But you're not a troubled teen because you're awesome. And you
exactly.
Like, you know,
I'm not troubled.
And I cut you off, and I apologize. I just want to establish who you were. What have you been working on since the last time you were on the show? I just want to make sure that everybody knew who you were before you were telling everybody what you're doing.
Yeah. I think that covers everything that I've done. No, I did another film with Patrick Muldoon in Texas.
Name
and that's
dropping.
Coming out, I think, in Christmas.
With more horses.
And then, it's another horse film, which I'm not good at riding
horses.
It's
going to be in the beginning of December.
At all, yeah. And then I did another movie called The Sparrows.
I thought it was a TV show.
It is. What they're doing is they made, a movie, and then I guess they're going to, cut it down and make it into the pilot for a TV show, and they're shopping it around to networks right now.
There's a large popular cast on that one, right?
Yeah, Kevin Sorbo, Judy Norton,
Hercules.
Oh my gosh, yes, it was so cool. Oh my gosh,
is he a really nice guy in person?
He's so nice.
I want him to be really nice in person.
He's tall. He's really tall. I'm 5 feet, and he's he's way taller than me. And then Judy Norton from the Waltons. And Christopher Adkins was in that one. He was Blue Lagoon. And I'm forgetting 80 million other people.
Have you seen Blue Lagoon?
I have. Okay. Yeah. When I found out that I was going to be working with Chris, I had to watch it. I was okay, I need to know what I'm getting into.
She's on first name basis with all these. Chris.
What do you think of Blue Lagoon?
Kevin is such a sweetheart.
Yeah, I thought it was actually pretty
Dean
good.
Deflected
really?
Some bullets for me the other day.
It was weird.
It was
to
weird.
To watch him, to see him afterwards, because he's completely the same. The way he talks, the way he makes his facial expressions, he hasn't changed at
just
all.
Just 30 years older.
Well, yeah. And so they put all of the cast in this big house. So at night we'd just hang out till way too late because we had to work the next day. And he's a really awesome guy.
Cool.
Okay. I'm sorry. I remember who's in The Sparrows now.
Okay.
James Duval from Independence Day and Donnie Darko, I don't know what else he's done. And then Valencia Allegarin from Black Jesus, I think, on Adult Swim.
Is she the... Oh, wait, is she the... She's not the cop, is she? She's the
she's the really, really gorgeous one.
That's in his crew. Right?
I don't know. I haven't watched the show.
Oh, okay. Well, there's one where there's a cop that's investigating Black
Adult
Jesus'
Swim
crew.
Comes on at midnight. She's usually in bed by then.
Listen, TV's TV. You can watch it at any time. It's called
exactly,
the internet,
yeah,
all right, Grandpa? Get up with the times. But yes, if she's the one I'm thinking of, she's the one that's in his crew, and she's the only girl in it. But yeah, she's awesome. The show's awesome.
She's so cool.
Yeah.
So I think that's
it.
Probably it.
That
for
is it.
That. And then when I go back to California, I'm filming a film in August called Fishes and Loaves, which they're doing the same. They're making a movie, and then they're turning it into a TV series. And then in January to February, I'm going to New Zealand for 6 weeks to film. It's like an adventure fantasy called Acalia something 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 stewardess.
Sounds
something,
awesome.
Something like that. Like something something something. it's like a working title, I guess.
And who's in like that one?
They want the dwarf king.
There you go.
From The Hobbit.
So Thorin Oakenshield.
Yeah.
The one you described as the hot dwarf.
Cool. Did you call him the hot dwarf?
Oh my gosh. The long hair and everything. Are you kidding?
We've had some interesting conversations over the last month.
You're 15 or 16?
I'm 15.
She'll be 16 in August.
Yeah.
26?
25th.
Ah, it's one of those days.
Exactly. It's within the whole month. So.
Have you ever been to New Zealand or Australia or anything like that?
Mm-mm.
Gorgeous.
I wanted
it
to go so bad.
It is absolutely gorgeous. You'll love it. You'll never want to come home. Just give you a heads up.
I've been to many places where I'm like, I'm staying. Like, I'm sorry, guys. I'm just going to, like, miss my flight.
And you just got back from New York.
Oh, my gosh. Yes.
Which is more of a vacation.
Oh, that was great. Yeah, my cousin graduated, and that was, like, her graduation trip. So he took her to New York. And we stayed right in Times Square. And that was another one where I was like, I think I'm going to stay here. Like, we found an apartment and we were like, oh my gosh, we can stay here. She can, like, not go to college.
Okay.
And so.
Not
decisions.
College, yeah, right.
Yeah, but then we came back because that's not okay. Because
life.
Yeah.
Yeah. You already learned that lesson. Life gets in the way. Speaking of life, we know you're going to graduate high school. Are you already graduated from high school right now?
I have my GED,
okay.
But I'm dual enrolled in college,
okay.
And so it's not really cheating the system, but as long as I'm in high school, I get my college free.
Yeah.
So I'm prolonging my high school until I'm, like, 17, 18,
mm-hmm.
And then I'll, like, graduate with my associate's degree, because I was going to graduate when I was 15, and then I started college on my 15th
mm-hmm.
birthday, and I was like, screw that, I'm not going to pay for college.
So
you're actually starting
yeah.
your senior year... Right now, right?
No. I'm starting my junior year.
Your junior year in high school, but you're also starting your sophomore year in college at the
yes.
same time.
Yeah.
And by the time it's all said and done, you're going to be out of there. What are you studying in college? You know yet? Or are you just
business
taking general?
What I do.
With a minor in film.
It's not about you, Lucas. We're talking to Amanda.
Same
okay?
I study. It's the cool ones.
So what do you want to be when you grow up? Which you're already almost grown up because you're
she's
going to
be
college.
She's going to be film school part two.
Can she answer the question?
I just want to be an actress and a director. And I'm planning on directing either the end of this year or the beginning of next year because I didn't realize it's June tomorrow.
It is.
And
oh, yeah.
Now you know when we're filming, but
well,
yes, June
true,
tomorrow.
That's true. It's June currently.
Mm-hmm.
And,
thank you.
And that is not enough time.
Unless you're watching in July or another
that's
month.
That's true.
And
I don't care.
We'll revisit the past. You and Lucas, you're like his protege. You're like his unofficial.
Daughter. We've known each other for a long,
I know.
Long
it's
time.
Been like.
We went over this story before.
Since before you were the troubled teen Summer that is sent to live with her uncle Kent and his family on the Arizona house ranch.
Mm hmm.
Okay.
Yeah, before
so,
that. Wait, before that.
I think we talked about the story on the last episode.
We'll revisit it a little bit.
I met her when she was 9. We figured this whole story out
because yeah.
it was there's a lot of time that goes by. But when she was 9,
6 years.
Her mm-hmm. her parents owned a catering company that was going to cater the film festival here in Detroit that I was part of. So they were coming to meetings, and there was a little 9-year-old running around in our meetings because her dad would bring her. And then at that film festival that we had put on, I did another show called The Red Carpet Show on YouTube, which you probably can't find. Maybe you can. Anyways... And I was interviewing this small little child that was probably 2.5 years old.
She was small.
And we had discussed that you can't put me next to a 2.5-year-old child and have a conversation because mm-hmm. I'm like
because
like
Harry Potter
giant.
Hadn't come out yet, so Hagrid
yeah,
talking
exactly.
to Harry
this
wasn't
is,
a thing.
Like
it
literally,
wasn't established.
If you know, there is video of it. She's like this big. Like I had a sandwich bigger than that today. So I frantically looked around because I didn't know who it was going to be. I didn't know this is how small she was. I just saw her on the screen. And the movie she was in was Annabelle and Bear. So if you can get a hold of that somewhere on the internet.
He loves that movie.
I do. I love that movie. It was made here out of Royal Oak, Michigan. So I found Amanda. She was selling popcorn at the film fest. So I'm like, you want to be in my show? And her parents said she could, and we filmed it, and we created another show like a month later called The Amanda and Lucas Show.
Yep.
That was the very first YouTube stuff we did. So, and then that led into other shows, which led into The Rack.
Yeah, it's so
She was my first co-star.
Full circle.
Mm-hmm.
You downgraded a lot, just to give you a heads up.
Well.
Thank you for settling for me.
You gotta settle. That. As you get older, you don't get that. That you once did when you were young. Write that down.
Okay, all right. I'll write it down right now.
But yeah, no, so we've known each other a long time. I became close with her family. Her parents are like having a second set of parents. It's a lot of fun. We hang out a lot when you're home.
Yeah.
Oh, that's cool. We talk a lot. I think Amanda and I are the only two people that can just like talk all day about nothing.
In Lucas's life.
And neither of us get bored with it. At least I don't.
I don't.
You're being nice. That's really nice.
We do.
Cameras are rolling.
As soon as the cameras turn off, I'm gonna be like,
"Look at how good of an actor she is." You understand why she's a big deal, right? Lucas bought that hook, line, and sinker.
Yeah, because what was it? A couple weeks ago, we went and we were supposed to shoot.
It wasn't that long ago. It wasn't
shoot camera.
Yeah, shoot camera.
Yeah, yeah.
I keep saying we're in Detroit. We're shooting people. No.
Well, that's what he said. He's like, let's go shooting. And I was like, I've never been shooting. I don't think my dad, like, wants you to take me. Because I think he wants to take me. And he was like, no, with the camera.
So we were supposed to go shooting photography. We didn't. We just got pizza. And then
how many pictures did you take, Lucas?
9 hours. I took 2.
Yeah, okay. When we got back to my house.
When we got back to her house. Like, of the garage sale that we were at. But it's like, we have to take at least a couple pictures, so it feels like we did something today.
Yeah.
But we ended up spending like 6 to 8 hours just bullshitting, essentially. It was fun.
It was a lot of fun.
What is your favorite thing to do when you come home to Michigan?
I know.
I'm talking to her, dude.
I know this one.
And you don't have to say talk to Lucas or hang out with
She's
Lucas.
In love.
I was not going to say that on camera. My favorite thing is, my cousin's here, so we hang out all the time.
Because
my cousin's my best friend.
They're like inseparable when they get here.
Yeah, she's awesome.
She's pretty cool.
She's so. It's the
you
want to
shout out to her?
Yes, this is the
New
York. You want to
shout out to her?
Shout out to your cousin right now.
She probably won't listen. She doesn't listen
to
anything that I do.
You should shout out to her anyway.
Yes. Or watch any of my movies. I'm like, hey, did you watch
it? Well, link her to this directly and say, hey, this involves you directly. If people love one thing, it's themselves.
Okay.
Do you have a nickname for her?
What?
Do you have a nickname for her?
Well, Sarah Vera.
Oh, Sarah. Talk to Sarah Vera on that camera right now. Go. Sarah Vera. Message.
All right. Good luck in college. And when you get back, we're going to New York. Again.
Are you guys really?
Oh, adorable.
But yeah, no, it's been fun. So you're a geek. We talked about last time you read a lot. Have you been reading anything?
Yeah, I just finished Dove, which is like, you don't know that book? It's like your time. It was...
Back in the Stone Age, when Lucas used to read on stone tablets.
All of a sudden,
it's
today
like,
is the day I feel
in
like
hieroglyphics.
It's the youngest guy to ever sail completely around the world.
Oh.
No, okay.
I don't know it either. It makes me think better.
He was like 15 when he sailed.
It's a true story?
And then, yeah, it's a true story.
Okay.
And he wrote this, he kept a journal. And this book is just his journal, and he includes photos and everything. And along the way, he got married. He lost a lot of cats because he'd bring cats onto his voyage. And he'd like dock somewhere, and they'd... like find a new owner. They're like, I like this person better because none of them liked
being on a boat.
Exactly. Yeah, he had a blind cat that would like she knew her way around.
Okay, I was about to
like,
say.
No.
What's the end
no,
of that?
No, she knew her way around. Like it was awesome, and so he included photos of that. And then I think she
did that blind cat also her. Leave because that's really hilarious.
Yeah,
it's
yeah.
Like you know what?
Like,
I might be blind, but I want off this boat.
All of them left. He got married, and he had a daughter, and he finished it in, like, 5 years. National Geographic did, like, a huge thing on him.
I'm actually interested in this now. You're
showing
this.
It's so cool. It's so cool. I can't remember what his name was. I think it was, like, Robert or something like that.
Okay.
But
wait, said
so that
it's called
good.
Dove.
Dove is the name of his book.
Okay.
I'm gonna check it out.
And a Mandalynn seal of approval.
Yeah. Oh, my gosh. It's so good.
Okay.
I picked it up, and I could not put it down. Which, luckily, it's like a short, it's a shorter book.
That's impressive. I'm just like, oh, I'm reading the Discworld series again. I'm on Pyramids by Terry Pratchett. Not nearly as impressive.
Okay, we have to make a deal. If you make that movie, I want to be...
one of the cats.
Yes.
Okay.
I just want to go on that and go around the world.
Well, yeah, exactly. Like, that's I'll be the guy like that'd be 5 to 10 years down the road when I have, like, this huge budget and I'm like, alright, Paramount,
I don't know. I'll be like,
fund this.
I'll be 63 then.
Well, Paramount watches all of our stuff, so obviously they're gonna know this is how it works. We're gonna start planning for this.
We're really good friends with insert CEO's name here.
Yeah. It'll just look like Japanese stuff.
But yeah, no, it's that's exciting.
Yeah, it's really, really awesome. And I'm in the middle of another book. Oh, no, what's the name of it, though? Oh, Bootlegger. It's a Kussler book about the Prohibition in the 20s.
Yes, I know of this book.
A good
tell the audience about this book.
This book, it actually takes place in New York on Fulton Street. One of the murders happens there. And we were on Fulton Street, like, the day later, because I was reading it at night, and then the next day, when
you
we were
went
in New York,
Fulton
we went to Fulton Street.
On purpose or on accident?
No, on accident. And I saw it, and I was like, oh my gosh! Oh my gosh! This is in my book! And people were like, what is, like, wrong with you?
She doesn't flip out for celebrities, but streets, she goes nuts!
I know! Streets,
she's like, oh, I saw Dean the other day, not that big of a deal. Oh my god, Fulton Street!
Yeah, no, it was really, really awesome. But the book's really good. It's about Isaac Bell, and he's one of these detectives, and they're trying to stop all of the bootleggers from, you know, paying off the Coast Guard and the police officers and stuff like that. And
very cool.
Because one of them shot their boss.
We're going to have all these links in the description below. Hopefully they're putting links up in our lower thirds to Amazon.com. That would be really great. Will/Amy, whoever's doing this. Those are our editors. Just so you know.
Just talk to a random camera. They'll know you're talking directly to
Amy,
them.
Amy, yeah. Will.
They can't see you on that one. That's hers.
Will. Lower third. Right there. Okay. Anyways, check it out. Buy books off of Amazon. They don't support us at all, though. So
maybe they will in the future. They'll look back on this and be like, hey, remember when you guys were a sponsor for us way before?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
There you go.
That would make our
money. Or you get audiobooks. From Audible.com. Yeah, Audible.com.
I'm just going to let you keep
another
going.
Commercial, another keep going. Another person that doesn't support us yet. So Audible.com, that's Audible.com. Lower third.
Okay, back to you. You're a 9-year-old beginning in Michigan, and you've made it to California. You've made all these movies, and you've been very successful, and you're very intelligent, and you're a pleasure to be around. What kind of advice would you give to anyone else? And I know that we kind of hashed this over in our Next Generation episode, but you've also had another year. You know,
yeah.
Another year older, you have a lot more life experience. What would you tell somebody maybe who doesn't live in California, somebody who doesn't live in Florida, somebody who's not in New York, you know?
Mm-hmm.
How'd you do it here before you got there?
I did drama for a really long time to, I guess, sharpen that skill set, because there's, like, a natural talent, but with any natural talent, you have to, you know, sharpen your skill, because it's not, I hate saying this, but it's not good enough, because everybody out in California and New York and everything, they're constantly training, and they're taking classes, and I mean, everybody gives 100%, but you have to give, like, 200%. So I did drama for the longest time, and then I just got an agent here, and we started taping auditions. That's how I booked my first movie, Machine Gun Preacher, with Gerard Butler. Oh, you know what? He's probably the biggest star I've ever met.
I was in Machine Gun Preacher with Gerard Butler, aka Leonidas from 300. Just name drop. Not a big deal.
And my scene actually ended up getting cut out.
No, you're there.
I mean,
the top of your head, I remember.
Yeah, and my fingers
I've seen most
and my
of
legs.
Movies.
I still get checks from it, so I mean, I don't care.
Yeah, royalty checks, there you go.
We
someone has spit take from Joe Mark, by the way. Anyway, sorry.
She's
go ahead.
Like, I get paid even though I wasn't technically in it.
I mean, you can't see my face, but
Joe
Moore's
actually his realization is like, people do that? Are you doing the wrong thing?
Now we're just trying to make Joe Moore spit take. Maybe next time.
But you're right. You have to do it a lot, even if you have natural talent. There was a quote. I was trying to get my phone to read the exact quote, but the quote goes something like, as artist or anybody that's practicing something, what separates you from, you know, not being one is that you have extremely good taste.
Mm-hmm.
Extremely good taste. But when you start off, your tastes are so good and your skills are so low.
Exactly.
That you have to work at it and work at it and work at it. And one day your taste is what got you there.
Yeah.
That's how you know you're good. But you're not good enough for your taste until later on in life when you've practiced it a lot and you've performed a lot or did whatever a lot.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's the same with, you know, sports. You can be great at football or soccer or whatever when you're young, but you're not going to go and go pro because you're not good enough.
Yeah.
You have to keep practicing.
Exactly.
And
you can always get better.
Exactly. And so I,
like learning to
auditions, I'd watch myself and see what I did, what I should do differently. And then I moved out to California and I started coaching. But you can start on tape. I mean, I know a lot of people who booked their first things on tape and then came out to California to film it.
And then there's even, I mean, you started off with doing YouTube videos, believe it or not. You did our videos.
Yeah.
So you just took any opportunity where you could get in front of a camera and just practice.
Exactly.
And do stuff. Like our guest last weekend, which was Christina, which we haven't done yet. But she's a YouTube person. That's where she does.
She's definitely not sitting 10 feet away from us.
Right
no.
there. Nope. Even though this episode is
in the future.
Ooh.
Time warp.
Wibbly wobbly timey wimey stuff. Corey is pulling out his hair off camera right now that we keep mentioning it. Anyway, but yes, you're right. Any opportunity you could to get in front. Now,
yeah,
you said that you coach now, and you said that you honed your skill set. You sharpened those skills. What practices have you done and do you do now to kind of keep yourself on top of your game?
A lot of it is scene study. And it sounds dumb to like explain it to other people, but it's basically just doing different scenes over and over and over again with partners. I mean, like the class that I'm in now, we'll get a partner and we'll work on it that week. And then we'll meet during the week 2, 3, 4 times a week for hours and then do it next week. And then we'll do it again for the other next week, you know, and just keep doing it and doing it. And then we'll change scenes. And then we'll change scenes again. And then we'll change scenes again. And it's just making sure that the emotions are there and the reactions are there and making sure that you can memorize quickly. And it's not really like a memorizing thing because a lot of actors are like, don't memorize, that's terrible. But it's just doing it enough that you remember how to do it, not memorizing empty words.
Okay.
Which is a tip that someone gave me a long, long time ago.
Do you remember who?
Just some acting coach.
So I didn't know if it was something. She was like, I was just having lunch with Steven Spielberg when I was 8.
Oh, yeah.
Me and Steven.
You know, Steve.
Stevie. Uncle Stevie, basically. He let me wear his hat one time. It was nice. now, you said that actors say that memorizing is bad. You shouldn't memorize lines. Lucas might know this because he's a film buff. I don't know how many people are watching or like me, but I did not know that actors are supposed to memorize their scenes. What do you mean by that?
You're
that kind of blows
supposed
my mind.
To memorize it, but it's kind of like with the emotion and everything. And some people will memorize the words, but not the emotions, and just read out the words.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of like when you're reading a book out loud,
Yeah. You're
not really listening to what you're saying,
mm-hmm.
you're not reacting to what you're saying,
mm-hmm.
you're just reading it,
mm-hmm.
and you're not supposed to do that. You're supposed to read it enough times, not even out loud. I mean, like, I don't read it out loud because I don't want it to sound stiff and boring, but it's just to remember it. Kind of like how you would remember someone's birthday or someone's address after writing it down so many times.
Mm-hmm.
And it's kind of like that.
Where it becomes your own. Is what you're
exactly.
You own it. You know, it's just a number that's just part of your life.
Like the Pledge of Allegiance.
Yeah.
When you're
yeah.
really young, you're reciting those words. You don't even know what half of those words mean.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's kind of like
and
that.
To the Republic for Richard stands.
Exactly, yeah. And
one nation under God, invincible, with liberty and justice for Paul.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Like, that's...
He's totally an American.
Oh, yeah. Can't you tell?
Which is sad.
And so you want to, like, stay away from that. But, you know, it just comes with practice. Because I was... Oh, my gosh. I'll watch videos from when I was, like, 10 or 11. And it's just... It's so bad. Like, I cannot watch it. It's terrible.
I have those videos, too.
No. Mm-mm.
Lucas
no.
watches
I
them
have
all
your
the
very
time.
First, I actually... We were just watching your very first YouTube video. When you interviewed that little Annabelle Greer girl.
Really?
Yeah. And you were tiny also. I was like, oh my god, she was small.
Yeah, well, I'm still 5 feet, but and you know, I was always a small
You were actually child. Louder than, I remember you were louder than the girl that played Annabelle, I forgot what her name was, she was 2.5 years old, and you would interview you, ask her questions, because you and I went over what questions you were going to ask, and you'd ask them with a confident voice, even your first time out, and she'd be like, how's it feel? It was just like so hard to mic her. We remember that. It was really a lot of fun.
I don't remember anything from that except for I remember it was like raining or something.
We remember
and then across
Jimmy?
The street, I do remember Jimmy.
See, remember Jimmy?
And
what
across
was our
the street,
camera
there
guy?
there were like M&Ms in like this building, and I bought them. That's my
that's
memory.
Your memory.
That's a 9 year old's memory of the first time
she had her priorities right, man. She's like, I remember the candy that I bought there.
Yeah,
that's important.
The peanut M&Ms. I mean, they were peanut M&Ms are just the best. Those are the M&Ms. Regular M&Ms do not compare to peanut M&Ms.
I agree.
See, peanut butter M&Ms though.
Those are
those
really
are
good.
Are you into the other ones though, like the birthday cake or the crispy?
The pretzel ones
or the
are
pretzel
really,
ones?
Really good too, and the peanut butter ones.
What kind of M&M do you want to see them make?
To like
what kind of if you could make an M&M flavor?
If I could make gosh, this is so hard. This is like so difficult. With chocolate though?
Yeah,
no, I mean,
you never had it?
No.
I'm telling her to say bacon M&Ms.
Bacon
by the M&Ms. Way.
I mean, I would go with like Dorito M&Ms.
Oh, gross. Come on.
But then I was like, but I don't think that combination would taste well. So
no.
I'm trying to like think of pistachio. That would be good, probably.
Like almond M&Ms?
I'm allergic to almonds.
So,
no, thank you.
All right.
Okay.
What about that orange chocolate? Yep, like it's a
orange, it's orange liqueur
like
chocolate.
Yeah.
But the big orange you throw down on the it breaks and
yeah.
slices?
Yeah.
No.
Well, that'd be good. I'd eat that in M&M form.
Like, that's how I feel about those orange. You come in at Christmas time, they come in a ball and you slam it and it breaks open, it becomes orange slices. The great thing about those is you want it. You see it in the store, and then you get through like three slices. You're just like, no.
Well, see,
I just wanted like a slice, but they don't sell it
M&Ms
in one slice. You get like 40,000 slices.
M&Ms are only that big, though. So you can eat like half a pack of M&Ms
and then,
like that and be good with it.
And then March rolls around, and you still have like 30 slices left. You're just like, shit, and you just throw the thing away.
I'd be fine with that M&M.
I've never had that.
Really?
I don't know what you're talking
about.
Okay, well, it's
your Ferrero
it's a
share was a big thing that you. I remember buying those for Christmas for almost every.
The guy just died.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh. No. It's like he's.
Someone's
gonna
keep making the childhood. I'm pretty sure.
I know, but like he came up with all this great stuff, and now he's gone.
Nutella.
I just had Nutella. I just had Nutella for breakfast. It was toast, Nutella, and banana slices.
That sounds delicious. So good. Jomar is applauding you because he approves of your breakfast.
Uh-huh. It was great. It was the first time I ever had it. And it was
you know
Sarah
what?
Eats it all the time. It's so good.
Jomar, how many of those are left in there? Those things. Yeah.
DewShine?
Okay, go pull
seven?
Two. Go get two. We're gonna do something here. This is impromptu because we're just BSing today. We didn't really have a show set up. I'm not going to lie to you. But I tried this earlier, and it's in my Instagram. You can follow me. I don't know what my Instagram is. It'll be, like, right here somewhere. It's called DewShine. I'm going to have our intern go and run and get them. I want two of them, and I'll pay for them later. Here he goes. You're going to see him go past
are you
the
getting,
back window.
Are you getting one for her and one for you?
No, I'm going to try to get cups.
Oh, okay. Because I was going to say, I want DewShine, too.
I've already had it. Try to find cups. This is how we do it on the Rack Show.
There you go.
Just like, eh.
Brandon, our intern, is helping us out, which is pretty awesome.
It's two. Oh yeah, I know.
I was.
We'll get back to it.
Well, yeah. While we were doing that, or while we're waiting on that, I was going to ask you. You showed how happy you were thinking about peanut M&Ms that one time back in the day. Mm-hmm. Is that an example of maybe some of the memories that you used to recall in your scenes to get yourself ready? I guess, or do you actually put yourself in the character's mindset? Like, do you draw on your own experience, or do you kind of make up your experience for the character?
It depends. I mean, like, when I was first starting out and I didn't really have the ability to draw on the character, uh-huh. I did use mine. Like, my great aunt had passed away when I was 10, and we were, like, really close. I would go over her house all the time. And so I would use that when I needed to cry. Uh-huh. Or I did a short film, and, like, one of my friends was supposed to die, so I thought of, like, this this like adorable kid, and he was my friend's little brother. And then as I like got more mature as an actor, and I worked with a coach for a while, I just had the ability to draw on the characters' emotions and put myself in their shoes and everything like that. But yeah, no, I did draw on stuff. Like, I used to carry around a photo of Sarah. Well, actually, I do still carry around photos of Sarah. But when I had to be really happy, I would look at a photo of her, and yeah.
For all you young kids out there, photos are pictures that are actually on paper yeah. and not on your phone or on the internet.
I've got, like, 3 photos of her in my wallet. Like, I have her senior photo and stuff. It's a paper wallet. It's paper that's folded with a rubber band around it, and it holds everything. Oh. You haven't seen it? I've had it for, like, 2 years. You can tell, too, because the paper is,
you never
like,
take out your wallet when you're with me.
That's because I don't like to have people, like, see it, because I write notes on it and stuff, and people are like, I'm going to buy you a wallet. And I'm like, I like my paper wallet. I can buy a wallet
let's see this paper wallet.
I
want to
see how big of a deal this is.
It's not that big of a deal. It's just a...
Well, Lucas is making it a big deal. I'm legit curious.
I've been around, oh my gosh, it literally is made out of, it's just a piece of paper with a rubber band.
It's just a piece of paper.
It's not even a hair tie.
That
see,
is falling apart. It's grocery list.
Woody Allen looks like 805 Spider Rock concert with a star.
Oh, yes. Okay.
Street cut.
That is rough.
Let's see, what is...
Why don't you just get new paper?
I don't need...
Is this words? Algonquin
yeah.
Wendigo.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. I'm going to give that back to you. I can't top that with anything else to say on there.
Oh, my gosh. Wow, it really does say...
I wasn't joking when I said Algonquin. Yeah.
It's... What is this? This is... Oh, my gosh.
It's not even a wallet. It's just paper wrapped around a bunch of cards.
Yeah.
And a hair tie.
That's all it is.
You're such a creative. You're a creative.
My dad did it.
It's just a card.
Oh, gosh. No.
It's a lot of makeup.
That is a lot of makeup.
It is a lot of makeup.
Oh, there's Sarah.
I know.
Sarah.
It's my favorite photo.
Show Sarah.
It's my favorite
Sarah. Aw, she graduated this year.
Yeah.
I don't know if we're allowed to do this. Is she a minor?
No, she's 18.
Aw.
She's almost 18.
Oh, she's
a
minor.
I want to get Starbucks after this.
It doesn't matter.
I just got
to.
We're just going through Mando. What does a 15-year-old have in their wallet? Here's a Starbucks. I got two of these yesterday.
I just love...
It's the like rewards card or whatever, and I guess I have to carry it because sometimes...
Do they sponsor you?
They don't do the... No. Oh. Like, when I want to pay for things, sometimes they don't have the machine to do it with your phone. And they're like, do you have your card? And I'm like, no. So now I have to carry it.
Starbucks.
I'm
going to
show you something.
Come
There's on. A really cool app that I've been using called Google Wallet. And you don't wrap paper around it, first off.
I like my paper wallet. I do have to change the paper. But my dad does it with, like, my postcards, like, with my face on it. Because when he's working, like, out of state or whatever, he can look at it every day.
We have a postcard. Oh, we already sent you that postcard. Yeah.
It's on my wall.
Yeah. You have a cool wall too. I've seen the pictures. Okay, so this I'm gonna open this up. We've never done a taste test. Have we ever done like a taste review thing?
Yeah, we did
on the
in
show?
Season one.
What
you
was
weren't
it?
There. We
I wasn't there. How was I not there?
You walked off screen to go do something in our very first live Steamtopia. No, Up in the Aether Part 2. Lucas was going to set up the Mr. and Miss Steampunk competition winners to come on our show. While he was gone, I did a taste test of chocolate gears, these orange chocolate gears that I want them to make M&M's out of. See, full circle. So yes, this is our second one, at least.
Okay.
DewShine. Which I remember thinking that this would be really refreshing.
You know,
what
you need now is cards and a cup.
There was no,
play water. No.
What do you call it?
Okay.
There was no alcohol in this.
This is what we should play Waterfall with next, after this.
Lucas just discovered Waterfall because he's 16
these are not
again.
I
felt 16
okay.
this week.
All right.
Yeah.
I cannot.
Okay,
do this.
Cheers. We're gonna try this.
No,
so, DewShine came out.
I can't do it.
This March of 2015. I know this stuff. It's just stuck in my head. It's by Mountain Dew, which is the Pepsi company, right?
Yep.
Pepsi. It is. Well, I've had it. They have not had it. All I gotta say is prepare to become a diabetic. Let's try this.
Well, it's made with real sugar, so.
You know what would be a lot more refreshing with this? Alcohol. Otherwise, that is a toothache.
What does that feel like, though?
Like, what's that? It's like a memory that you can't grasp. That's how I feel. Right? It's like a memory you can't grasp. You're like, I don't know.
It's...
What was her name last night? That's what this feels like. You're just like, I vaguely remember...
15! She's 15! What am I making those jokes with her here?
I was... Whatever.
Anyway.
It's not the first time.
All I'm saying is you can't grasp the memory. It's familiar, yet totally a stranger. You know, like...
Honestly, it kind of reminds me of... Oddly enough, I gotta agree with Lucas. It reminds me of a memory that I had way back in the day when I used to go up north with my grandparents to their property. But off of Lake George in Michigan.
You're grasping a memory, though.
I know, but that's what it reminds me of.
Oh, okay.
You're the one who can't remember.
That's what I'm saying. I can't remember it. It's just like, I think it's like alcohol. I think what it is it's supposed to taste a little bit like alcohol.
Yeah.
But it doesn't taste like alcohol because you don't have the burn.
You know what?
That's why it's called DewShine.
Like lemon Bacardi in this. Something lemony. It'd be really, really good in this. Joe Mars.
Even though like half of our audience is 16.
Well, drink responsibly when you're of age and 21. Guess how old I am? Over 21. So... Yes, I have this thing in my head. Okay, let's give everybody a heads up. Story from when I was a little older than Amanda.
Story time. Wait a second.
Whenever I drank a bottle with a cap on it.
How old were you when you were drinking bottles with caps in?
Like this? Like yeah. Non-alcoholic?
Oh, non-alcoholic. Okay.
I was saying any time I had a cap, I would stick it to my forehead so that I could keep track of it. That way it didn't get lost if I ever had to recap it. And now, whenever I drink something with a cap... Running my forehead.
He was totally the popular kid in school.
Oh, yeah. You can tell.
Yup. That's all I'm saying about that. Anyway.
What do you mean Stacy Sue didn't invite me to her party?
No, what's great is when people try to do it for you, and then they try to put it on this way. And then they want to
watch
the stick and they go,
like, I don't...
You just find the sweet spot.
Can you do it? You do it.
I don't know how to do this.
You just gotta find the
sweet
spot.
You gotta lick it?
No.
Do you just...
Oh!
Got it!
Joe Mars. Right,
see, and now you're being really careful that you're trying not to move around, trying not to make facial expressions. Like I said, you'll learn the money spot. Chibi Lucas, a.k.a. Joe Mar, figured it out.
That's weird. I didn't know about that. That's cool. So, what do you guys think? What do you think?
The more I drink it, the more I'm okay with it.
Yeah.
To be honest, when at first I was like, oh, so sweet.
You're right,
I still want to mix it with alcohol because I'm a responsible adult who will do that and not drive. But yeah.
He'll just sleep here.
There's a couch. There's a couple of them.
There is.
Okay, so I think we're going to wrap this up.
Are we? You sure?
We're just now.
I just think, TurboNug.
Yes.
We're supposed to talk about that. He's about to walk in. He's like, you didn't say it. So I was supposed to bring it up organically, but that was totally not organic.
I thought we were going to bring it up with our show in the past. We're bringing it up with her?
Yeah, because it's her that's a TurboNug.
All right.
I don't know.
I'm supposed to say what I think TurboNug is.
Yeah, what do you think a TurboNug is? Okay, so we were discussing the show on the internet last night, and we have our own little VoxVii chat. And I called her a TurboNug, a term I learned from some other chaperones this weekend at Special Olympics. Hello, Brian, and I don't remember your brother's name.
Brian's brother.
Pete! Brian and Pete. So, yeah, they're two brothers that volunteered with us. They're really great guys. And they kept using this term, TurboNug. I didn't know what it meant until, like, the last day. I'm like, you gotta explain that. Because I don't know what you're saying. And he did. I'm like, oh, that's a cool term. I'm gonna try to use it. I tell about it on the show. I'm like, I'm gonna do that.
And I'm supposed to guess what this is.
Yeah, what's a TurboNug? TurboNugget. TurboNug. Either way.
My mind instantly goes, it's not right. I know it's not right. I don't even want to say it.
Say it.
Like, a really fast shooting small piece of poop out of your butt. That's what I. It's,
thank
and,
you.
And it hits the water and it splashes really, like,
have you
like
had
large.
This, have you had this
I've had
experience?
I've had all sorts of poops. I think everyone has. So that's what. So when I say Turbo Nugget or Turbo Nug, that is the very first thing. But since you're calling,
you're gonna have to
Mandalynn a Turbo Nug. I feel like that's not it because
you
I don't think you can make that.
I gotta interrupt that because that's hilarious.
Like you're such a Turbo Nug.
You have to now write the sequel to Everyone Poops, which is an actual book, and you need to write a sequel to that book saying, and here are the types of poops.
There's a book already about that. I think it's called Poop Talks, and it's literally a toilet book where you can look up the different kinds of poops that you have, and it tells you what's going on in your body.
Links in the description, and hopefully in the lower thirds.
Like, hey, this is what happens.
Will's gonna be googling.
Christina's
like
crying
gonna
over
be like,
here.
Poop Talks.
Our guest for last week is crying.
You're gonna be looking at Will's history, his search history. It's gonna be like. Poop talks. No.
But it's like, hey, what does it mean when you have rabbit poops? Hey, what does it mean
That's awesome.
When you have gigantic ones that you don't have to wipe a lot? It's called, like, the euphoria poops. It exists. It's already out there.
Okay.
Anyway, but
do you
I am...
it?
No, I don't.
Do you want to own it?
Are you going to buy it for me? I'd read it. Yeah, sure. If it's
I'm sort of interested. Do you know?
It tells you what's going on in your body.
You know what I mean?
It's like a health book.
I'm moving into a new house
soon. It's health.
We should put this in the new bathroom.
Yeah.
So when you guys come over, you can get educated on your shit.
Along with how to survive.
Literally get educated on your shit.
Along with how to survive a Sharknado, which is already in his bathroom.
Yes, I do have how to survive.
A shark.
Also, 911 calls is another one. I don't know who reads those, but I guess people do.
I read the covers. I've never touched it.
Do you really?
I'm not going to touch a book in your bathroom, dude.
They're there for other people. I was always told it was polite to leave books in your bathroom for people. So they've always been there. I've never read them, honestly. They're just like bathroom books. My first roommate when I was a kid.
I've heard that they're in case you run out of toilet paper.
No,
you're like,
no.
Any port in a storm.
No.
Sorry, how to survive a zombie apocalypse. I gotta do this.
You're not even a zombie apocalypse. I don't remember what I was supposed to do. I wiped my ass with that page.
Actually, I would never do that to that book because that's an important book.
That's another book. How to Survive a Zombie Apocalypse was another book.
No, what is it? It's Max Brooks. How to Survive...
A zombie apocalypse?
Is this a zombie apocalypse?
Yeah, it's a zombie survival guide.
Yeah, thank you. That's what I meant.
Sorry.
Yeah, don't use that for toilet paper.
And then we have How to Survive, and then it talks about snake bites, and it's all actually real
information. I have that one.
And then How to Survive Sharknado was another book that I have in that bathroom. Anyways, I have all kinds of really weird books.
Anyway, so Turbo
Nug. So if you guys
ever
want to come over to my house
and
have, read my bathroom library.
Yeah, it's available, but I was wrong with Turbo Nug.
So what do you
obviously
think Turbo Nug is?
I don't think that I can even follow up that guess.
So it comes from the word nugget.
Okay, figured.
And there's many, if you look it up on Urban Dictionary, I believe it is, there's bunch of different definitions.
Oh, gosh.
One of them references weed. One of them references something that high schoolers do with backpacks, where you steal somebody's backpack, you turn it inside out, put all their stuff back in it, and then zip it back up. And that's called a nugget. Because you can't put it on anymore. All the straps and everything's inside because it's inside out. And then they have to take this thing, they call it the nugget. When the bell rings, they can't take all their stuff out of the backpack and then turn it inside out. Which I thought is a hilarious prank. And I truly want to try that one day.
But the only person that carries a backpack with us is me.
No, I do.
You carry a backpack?
Every now and then, yeah.
But not your
all I'm saying
backpack.
Is you're going to get nuggeted.
Wait.
That sounds terrible.
When do you, do this to someone?
Usually it's in high school. This is a high school.
But we go to conventions, so...
So we usually do have backpacks. We have conventions.
I would love to nugget crows, if you ever carried a backpack.
Oh,
that'd be great.
He doesn't watch the show anyways. The other term is a child that does adorable childish things. But no.
Oh, okay.
Now, a Turbo Nugget is like a modified thing of that. Turbo Nugget is somebody that's absentmindedly is adorable. Like, they don't know why
they're trying it.
They're not trying it. They're just like, what is that? So, we had a lot of Turbo Nuggets that we worked with this weekend.
Like the girl who called you Toby Keith?
Yeah.
I saw you?
Yeah. There was two girls there, two of the athletes at Special Olympics, and one would yell my... Well, she was watching the, what was that last episode that we did?
Living History
episode. Essentially, Civil War reenacting type stuff.
No,
but it's not the Civil War, it's the War of 1812.
There you go.
Corey. It's more popularly known as
the first siege of Fort Meigs. It's a great episode, by the way. You need to check it out. Shout out to
shout out
to Will, who did an amazing job editing, and to Corey's dad, who really helped us out. It was phenomenal. It really was.
So we were in the hall, and I was spinning on my cell phone. We were doing a dance party in the hall.
Okay.
It was adorable. And they were there, and then I ended up turning on this, because you sent it to us, and I turned on the video, and they were asking me what it was, and they watched it, and any time I would pop up, they would go silent, and they would just wait for me to come back on. And as soon as I came back on, one would yell, Lucas, and the other one would be Toby Keith, and I don't understand the second part of that. I really don't. And sometimes you're just like, yep, whatever.
Well,
but
she was a turbo nugget.
They were both
turbo nuggets.
They were both turbo nuggets.
Okay. So that's where the term turbo nugget comes from. I was potentially still right, but not in the sense that Lucas was thinking. Is that why you wanted me to guess? Because you knew that I would just pick something completely wrong?
I just wanted to see what you would say.
Was it worth
but
it?
But you're a turbo nugget.
You're a turbo nugget.
You could be here. You're like
the good
absent-mindedly.
I'm trying to remember.
You're not that fast-moving shit. You're absent-mindedly adorable sometimes.
Yeah, I'll have to go back into the conversation to see what I said. That, like, prompted you to call me a
turbo nugget. Yeah, you said something. I forgot. I'm like, oh, you're a turbo nugget. And I'm going to use that term now. Anytime I see
turbo
it,
nug.
You're a turbo nug.
Okay.
Anything else?
No, I don't think so. This has been another episode of The Rack. Conrad's going to wrap us up here.
I like how my questions were like, where do you draw your inspiration from? And what kind of training do you do? And Lucas is like, let's drink DewShine and talk about turbo nugs.
Hey. Whatever.
Mandalynn Carlson, thank you very much for being on the show. Always a pleasure to have you. It's always great when you're back home, obviously, when you're back home again. We might not have you on the show, but we will
absolutely
hang out with you and play games
fall,
and be around. You're one of our favorite
in the fall, we're supposed to be doing Next Generation, right?
Next Generation Part 2?
Maybe not. Whatever.
I'm happy to co-host that if you want to.
Yeah.
I don't know what that hair flip means, her doing
this. I really did not mean that. My hair was just like in the way. But
totally
it was kind of like a...
And you still have the cap on.
That was a turbo nug moment.
See?
There you go.
The turbo nug moment.
But for Lucas, I'm Conrad. Thank you very much for watching Season 3, Episode 12 of The Rack Show on VoxVii's YouTube channel, VoxVii.com, and TheRackShow.com. Check out more of our stuff on Instagram and on Twitter. The Rack Show, all one word. DewShine. Pretty okay.
Turbo nugs. Somebody add that to Urban Dictionary.
Probably already there.
Nope, I looked it up.
Really? Why did you do it?
Because I want somebody else.
Be the change you want to see in the world, Lucas. Come on.
Turbo nug revolution. Peace, guys.
We dubbed it the Summer of Challenge.
Which it was really the episode of Challenge.
It had a really cool concept where we were going to let viewers and listeners and people who like us on Facebook to give us suggestions about challenges that Lucas and I can partake in. And then whoever lost had to have some sort of punishment.